Thank you. The next item, the final item of business, is a member's business debate on motion 10584 in the name of Willie Coffey on Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month. This debate will be concluded without any question being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Willie Coffey to open the debate. Mr Coffey.
Presiding Officer, thank you once again, and thank you to all the members who supported the motion to enable us to highlight the issue of pancreatic cancer during this month of November. The Parliament has a good record of doing this, and I'd like to acknowledge the efforts of my colleague Claire Adamson, who has been at the forefront of bringing this subject to our attention over many years. Members might also recall the moving speech from our former colleague John Scott, who spoke very movingly in 2020 about his illness and his recovery. Presiding Officer, it was one of those moments in the life of this Parliament when we can all be grateful for the opportunity that we have to come to this place and share some of the important things in life. No doubt we'll hear from members across the Chamber of their own family experiences or those of constituents, and I'm no different. My mother died from this disease in 1985, and while that seems almost half a lifetime ago, I can assure you it's as painful today as it was then. It never gets any easier for me or my sister, Helen, and our family who remember her and still miss her. I'm grateful as ever to the team at Pancreatic Cancer UK, and I think some of the colleagues are in the gallery tonight, and I welcome them there, who provided us with some really helpful facts and figures about this particular cancer. If one message comes from the briefing they provided, it's this: if we act quickly, we can save more lives. More than half of the people who get this cancer will not survive more than 3 months from their diagnosis. Around 70% of people won't receive any treatment. Only 1 in 4 will survive beyond a year. And only 12% of people diagnosed actually use the various support channels that are in place. Alarmingly too, most people can't name the most common symptoms that may, and I stress, may indicate pancreatic cancer. Anyone experiencing one or more of the most common symptoms, back pain, indigestion, tummy pain and weight loss for more than 4 weeks should contact their GP. Anyone experiencing jaundice should head straight to A&E to have this checked. I stress again, Presiding Officer, these may not necessarily be indicators of pancreatic cancer, but it helps to know these symptoms and to get checked out as quickly as possible. These are all pretty desperate and alarming statistics, but it can change. There is some light at the end of the tunnel. The Scottish Government has specifically committed to improving pancreatic cancer survival rates in its cancer plan. Through the Scottish Diagnostic Pathway Improvement Project, the aim is to speed up diagnosis and to help improve the care we offer to pancreatic cancer patients in Scotland. Within the pathway, according to Pancreatic Cancer UK, Scotland is leading the way in speeding up diagnosis, which is critical for patients, and the early results are encouraging. As I said at the outset, time is critical, and speeding up all aspects of the patient journey are so important. The indications from the pilot are that people are getting multiple tests as soon as possible, and so far, around 12% of patients in the pilot health board areas are getting that all-important early diagnosis that can save their lives. This pilot is only funded for 2 years, and clearly, if it is helping them, I'm certain the government will consider extending this work. And hopefully, the Minister might say something about that later. Pancreatic Cancer UK's Don't Write Me Off campaign focuses in on the urgency for this faster and concurrent diagnostic pathways. And the need for this was all too evident and painful to read in the case study about the lady from Fife, who tragically did not get any treatment due to delays and repeated tests. Presiding Officer, research and innovation has a key role to play, and Scotland is also leading the way. Pancreatic Cancer UK has invested over £500,000 to support research and a variety of awards, particularly the Future Leaders Academy at the Beatson, providing 5 early career scientists with training and mentorship to help them on their journey to becoming pancreatic cancer specialists. All of those 5 students managed to complete their PhDs, even during COVID, and their work is beginning to leverage in other funding for their research labs. Pioneering research is also taking place towards a potentially new, groundbreaking treatment for the cancer, which involves immunotherapy treatments. The good work being done by Precision Panc in Glasgow is still ongoing and focuses on matching up molecular profiles of patients with the most effective clinical trials that are available. I'm sure we offer our full support to everyone working in this important area of research. Presiding Officer, I see this opportunity in this debate as one of the most important contributions we can make as members of this Parliament. It's about highlighting an extremely dangerous and life-threatening cancer that even now, as we speak, the public don't know much about. Our job is to bring this to the attention of our constituents, informing them of the risks, but offering some reassurance of the great work being undertaken to try and improve this situation. Everyone in Scotland must be able to access these services that are giving us so much hope through the pilots and through the research. If we can save time, Presiding Officer, we'll save lives. So I'm looking forward to hearing the contribution of other members during the rest of the debate. And with that, I'll bring my contribution to a close. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Coffey. And I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Miles Briggs. Ms. Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Willie Coffey for securing this debate and picking up the baton for this year's debate in the Scottish Parliament. And just to reassure the Sea of Purple in the gallery that I might not be holding the baton, but I'm still running the race with you and everyone who is in the fight to raise awareness of pancreatic cancer and to find the much needed advances in this disease. And I also want to thank Willie again for mentioning John Scott and that very powerful speech that he made about his wife and his own situation. We wish his colleagues hope will take our best wishes back to him. It's a really important to increase public awareness, and as always, I'm going to reiterate what some of the symptoms are to look out for. As Mr. Coffey had said, many people cannot name a single symptom of pancreatic cancer, but these symptoms are often commensurate with other conditions. Common symptoms include back pain, indigestion, tummy pain, unexplained weight loss, and loss of appetite. Anyone with jaundice should immediately go to an accident and emergency department. Increasing public awareness of some of these symptoms is absolutely vital, as early diagnosis and intervention is the best way to be able to treat and survive this cancer. I'm pleased to say that Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month is now a firmly held annual fixture in the Scottish Parliament. This in itself is a mark of the progress in bolstering pancreatic cancer in the policy agenda in Scotland. Pancreatic cancer campaigners, many of whom are in the gallery this evening, and many of whom have become friends, are a pleasure to work with. It's their advocacy and the bravery of those with lived experience of the disease that has brought this debate to the Chamber for its 6th year. I was delighted to host Pancreatic Cancer UK in the Parliament earlier this month too, and a cross-party contingent of MSPs came and took part in a photo call as part of PCUK's Don't Write Me Off campaign on the garden lobby steps. And campaigners were able to speak to MSPs about their experiences in the drop-in session. I had some difficult but heartening conversations with the campaigners who came along. Nicole MacDonald spoke about her dear friend Danielle, who sadly lost her life to pancreatic cancer in June. Nicole and Daniela's mother, Diane, spoke with such passion and warmth of this really young woman, and her resilience was evidenced in their thoughts. Danielle's wry humour following her diagnosis may have been a point of occasional frustration to her mother and Nicole, but it was a wonderful mark of her character in the face of such tribulation. I never had an opportunity to meet her, but from speaking to Nicole and Diane, it was clear that throughout her illness, Danielle remained indelibly herself. I was utterly touched that Nicole gave me the pin I'm wearing this evening, and I will wear it proudly out every November in memory of Danielle. And I thank you once again for coming to speak to us about her. I've previously spoken about a cause of optimism, a quality that's hard to come by when you're talking about pancreatic cancer. The central cause of optimism is that with early intervention, pancreatic cancer can be survived. And there are innovations in treatment across Scotland. I've spoken previously about the exemplary work of Precision Panc in Glasgow. NHS Scotland has launched a new initiative with the innovative virtual cancer care team to speed up the diagnosis and treatment for those with two of the deadliest forms of cancer, pancreatic cancer being one of them. A Scotland-wide two-year project included in the recently published Cancer Action Plan for Scotland will triage patients who have been referred by local healthcare teams for suspicion of pancreatic cancer, and this should allow for swift diagnosis and reduce delays. Other promising developments include a clinical study to develop a breath test that could detect pancreatic cancer, and a team at Imperial College London, led by Professor George Hannah, are studying how breath samples taken in GP surgeries could ensure people with early pancreatic cancer symptoms, which can be mistaken for other things, could be ruled out at a very early stage if this test becomes available. So as Pancreatic Cancer UK puts it, we need to go faster. And I, as I say many times when I'm speaking about this disease, what are weeks and months and years for other cancers are seconds and minutes and hours when it comes to pancreatic cancer, because it can be such an aggressive and such a short time that people have to deal with it and live with it after diagnosis. And that's the pivot that we have to make. We have to get there earlier. We have to give people, as Linda Murray always says, I have to just give people a chance. So thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Adamson. I now call Miles Briggs to be followed by Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'd like to start by thanking Willie Coffey for securing this evening's debate and welcome those who have joined us in the public gallery this evening as well, but also to pay tribute to Claire Adamson, because she has committed to bringing this debate forward in all the time I've been in Parliament. So very much thank her for this opportunity in the past, because this has become an important point for us as a Parliament to come together and consider the issues. Because many of us in the Chamber will have personal knowledge of someone who suffered from pancreatic cancer, be they a family member or a friend or a colleague or a constituent as well. And I think that's one of the things I certainly am always moved by, people who contact us beyond these debates. And I'd like to thank colleagues for mentioning John Scott and his personal experience in the speech he made in one of these debates. I saw John actually at the Highland Show this year. He's doing well. He's always emailing us to keep us on our toes as well in Parliament, so it's always good to see and hear from John, and he is doing well, so thank colleagues for their comments. As Willie Coffey outlined, the real cruelty of the disease and pancreatic cancer is especially hard to detect, and this, allied with the lack of timely treatment and care, means that the chance of best quality of life is significantly altered and lowered by many people who discover cancer, often in an A&E setting. Just under 900 people are diagnosed with pancreatic cancer every year in Scotland, and pancreatic cancer survival has not shown any real improvement over the last 50 years. In Scotland, pancreatic cancer is the deadliest common cancer, with more than half of people dying within the first 3 months of diagnosis, and 7 out of all people receiving no treatment. Last year, I raised a number of issues around decisions to treat and around a call for long-term funding to embed the learnings of the Scottish Diagnostic Pathway Improvement Project into our NHS. And it is good to see some of the work which is happening around that. And I was pleased with others to attend the Pancreatic Cancer UK drop-in recently held in Parliament and speak to a number of patients and family members around their issues which they wanted to raise and see change around. Pancreatic Cancer UK has worked with experts across the field to develop faster, fairer, funded, the optimal care pathway that will inform how best to diagnose, treat and care for pancreatic cancer patients. And I do think that decision-making around decision to treat is something we still need to see far more work taken forward. The cancer workforce planning is critical to this, and funding for specialist pancreatic cancer roles in every health board across Scotland, for example, and the delivery of the workforce plan in the Scottish Government's cancer plan needs to be the number one priority, I believe, for us to be able to achieve what we want to see in this. I very much welcome the Scottish Government has committed to improving pancreatic cancer survival, but we now need to see what that looks like in reality within the plan. And that requires action, not just words, if we're to ensure that improvements become a reality. And it is hoped that by implementing the optimal care pathway, significant progress can be made to improve treatment for people and that decision to treat importantly being taken. And if we are to see this work significantly progress, then we need to see what is an opportunity for Scotland, I think, the doubling of treatment pathways and the survival rates we can see. That would see around 400 more people in Scotland living longer and better lives over the next 5 years. And whilst we have to be honest, and I think this debate always is an honest debate, around the current statistics painting that challenging picture, we know that early diagnosis and treatment can improve the lives with people with pancreatic cancer. Deputy Presiding Officer, Scotland does have an opportunity to lead the way in the United Kingdom in how we improve survival and treatment of pancreatic cancer. And with focus and determination, we can help move Scotland and the UK from one of the worst performing countries to one of the best, I believe. Everyone in the chamber has a duty to their family, friends and constituents to hold the government to account on this, ensure that we stand by the commitments which we've made to try to improve those survival rates. And for those in Scotland suffering from pancreatic cancer, as others have mentioned, time is a luxury they do not have, so we must act now and we must make this a priority. I've spoken in every debate since I was elected, and that's because I know we can make a difference. And I know that each campaigner I've met, an individual and family who I've worked with, who have lost loved ones to pancreatic cancer, are demanding that we do better. And like Claire Adamson said, whenever I meet campaigners, it's a very odd feeling because you come away with hope on what is such a negative time they've had, because they know that's not going to make a difference for their loved one, but they are demanding that we make a change for other people's families and loved ones. Today's debate, I hope, shows that we do always have them in mind and that we do want to continue to work to improve treatment and pathways, but above all to celebrate the lives of people we have lost to pancreatic cancer. They are all individuals who we need to celebrate, and I hope today's debate gives us that opportunity to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. I now call Carol Mochen to be followed by Beatrice Wishart. Ms. Mochen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I also thank Willie Coffey for bringing this debate to the Chamber this evening. And on behalf of Scottish Labour, can I welcome the recognition of Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month and World Pancreatic Cancer Day, which is marked tomorrow. It is critical that we take time to mark these times of awareness, and I wish everyone involved with Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month the best in the work being carried out tomorrow and for the rest of the month. Raising awareness of illnesses, other members have said, such as pancreatic cancer, is pivotal to ensuring early diagnosis and improving the prognosis. Indeed, I consider it important to highlight in the chamber, as I have done, like yourself, I have spoken in the debate since I've been elected in previous years, and the key symptoms are key here. We know that this is the problem, that people do not recognise the key symptoms of pancreatic cancer, which include abdominal or back pain or discomfort, unexplained weight loss or loss of appetite, yellowing of the skin or eyes, an itch or itchy skin, a change in bowel habits, nausea or vomiting, and indigestion that does not respond to treatment. Knowing those symptoms and seeking medical advice, even as a precaution, can be life-saving or life-prolonging. And it's key that we continue to support the public awareness campaigns on this, as all members have said. Presiding Officer, according to Pancreatic Cancer UK, only 8% of people can name the most common symptoms of pancreatic cancer, and that is far too low. We know that, and to save and prolong lives, we must increase the numbers significantly. At this point, I would like to thank the various organisations who have contacted me ahead of today's debate and members of the public who have had family members affected. The briefings are always really important and highlight the sheer scale of the challenge we face when it comes to recognising the sort of destructive nature of pancreatic cancer. And we always appreciate the work that has gone in to putting those briefings together for us. We know from research, and other members have mentioned research and the importance of research in the chamber tonight, that pancreatic cancer is the deadliest common cancer. More than half of people die within 3 months of diagnosis, and 7 in 10 people with pancreatic cancer never receive any treatment, often because of that late diagnosis. This is a significant challenge which demands immediate response, as others have said, and this is why I give my full support to Pancreatic Cancer UK's Don't Write Me Off campaign, which sets out 3 priorities for diagnosis, treatment and care, and by making these things faster, fairer and funded. As I noted, Presiding Officer, many pancreatic cancer sufferers will not receive treatment, and we need that diagnosis and that treatment to be much faster. As I often mention in the Chamber, I want to talk a little bit about inequalities which exist in terms of people seeking support and treatment, the sort of socioeconomic health inequalities that create the very deep and divisive and damaging inequalities in our communities also matter in these circumstances, so that we support people to, whenever they can, go forward, speak to the GP, speak to a local nurse, so that they can, even if it's just a precaution, it's always worth it. We need to address funding, as has been said. Support for patients in this motion often talks about the fact that we do need funding and we do need services, and the NHS is struggling at times, particularly with long waiting times, slow diagnosis, lack of readily available treatment. So we must address this, and we must look at the funding sources for this. The NHS is, I think everybody would agree, our proudest possession. It certainly is my party's proudest creation, and we would be letting people down if we were not honest about the things that we need to do. So thank you to everyone in the gallery and to all the members who have spoken.
Thank you, Ms Morgan. I now call Beatrice Wishart to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Willie Coffey for bringing this important debate to the Chamber this afternoon. I'd also like to thank the organisations who provided briefings to the parliamentarians for today's debate, including Pancreatic Cancer UK and Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland, and for the great work that they do. I note the timeliness of the debate in the middle of Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, with World Pancreatic Cancer Day tomorrow. As others have alluded to, pancreatic cancer is the deadliest common cancer, with more than half of people dying within 3 months of diagnosis, many never receiving treatment. The statistics are stark. Scotland has one of the worst 5-year survival rates in the world, ranking 32 of 33 countries with comparable data. But there is hope for the future, for early diagnosis, which would save lives. Pancreatic Cancer UK's Don't Write Me Off campaign is calling for a faster, fairer, funded pathway through diagnosis, treatment and care. It's estimated that an optimal care pathway could double treatment and survival rates, seeing over 400 more people with pancreatic cancer in Scotland living longer and better lives over the next 5 years if it was introduced today. The pathway for patients from my constituency is shared between NHS Shetland and NHS Grampian, but like other areas, too often, by the time of diagnosis, there is little time left for the patient. Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland highlighted in their briefing from their Share Your Story campaign that patients will visit their GP an average of 4 times before being diagnosed. 43% of all pancreatic cancer cases are diagnosed by emergency presentation. As Willie Coffey suggested in his opening remarks, We all have stories to tell of family or constituents or loved ones. And, Presiding Officer, I have permission from the family I'm going to talk about to mention their loved ones. Shetland is an island community. We like to think that we all know each other, and that's true up to a point. In times of loss and deep sadness, we come together to support each other. In the summer of 2019, I attended the funeral of a friend, Alexis. The hall where the service was held was packed. The community was in shock and came to pay respects and offer sympathy to the family for the loss of someone who was held dear and taken from us too young. Pancreatic cancer had claimed another person. Time moved on, and led by Alexis' husband, Bobby, the family did a 26-mile charity fundraising walk for pancreatic cancer. In the spring of this year, we gathered again in the same place for another funeral, this time for Bobby. Almost unbelievably, pancreatic cancer had cruelly visited this family again. The children and extended family were dignified throughout, but the pain, grief, and heartache etched on the faces of those who loved Bobby and Alexis most was plain for all to see. The loss of Alexis and Bobby has been keenly felt too by their work colleagues. Alexis worked in a local solicitor's practice, and Bobby was a successful businessman in the house building sector. The ripples of this devastating disease extend out far into the wider community, and Alexis and Bobby are deeply missed by so many. To conclude, Presiding Officer, as the motion highlights, survival rates for pancreatic cancer have barely changed in 50 years, and we need to change this. More needs to be done to help us reverse the stark numbers. More research and early diagnosis are the main calls which I'm sure all of us in the Chamber support. We need to move faster. We cannot have another lost 50 years.
Thank you, Ms. Wishart. I now call Gillian Mackay to be followed by Marie McNair. Ms. Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too would like to begin by thanking Willie Coffey for bringing forward this debate and for sharing his personal story, and to pay tribute to Claire Adamson for her work on this as well. I'd also like to thank the organisations involved in the support of those with pancreatic cancer, including Pancreatic Cancer UK, who have provided tireless and invaluable support to those with cancer and who are the UK's leading funding specialists into pancreatic cancer research, driving innovative research to find breakthroughs that will change how we understand, diagnose and treat pancreatic cancer. As Beatrice Wishart just said as well, Pancreatic Cancer Action do great work in raising awareness of symptoms and the stories of those who have direct experience of pancreatic cancer. Whilst the survival rates have improved enormously for most cancers, for pancreatic cancer this is sadly not the case. Currently, more than half of people diagnosed with pancreatic cancer pass away within 3 months. With the majority of cancer, early detection and awareness of symptoms are essential in identifying cancer early. However, with pancreatic cancer, this is difficult due to the generally vague symptoms that it presents. Symptoms of mild back pain, indigestion, tummy pain, nausea symptoms that often sound like stomach upset and other illnesses are often dismissed. I met a constituent at a parliamentary reception earlier this session, and I was given a card with a short version of their family's story, and it's stayed on the pin board in my office ever since. And I wanted to share it today in their words because it so clearly demonstrates how difficult and devastating this cancer can be. Until 2013, we knew nothing about pancreatic cancer. In December 2012, our daughter, who turned 25 that month, had extreme vomiting, which was initially thought to be norovirus. Due to her getting no better and losing weight rapidly, she saw a GP on the 7th of January 2013. Due to extremely high bilirubin levels, she was immediately admitted to hospital, where she had a number of tests carried out. On the 18th of January 2013, our world fell apart when our daughter was diagnosed with stage 4 inoperable pancreatic cancer. She had a 4-year-old daughter at the time, and they both moved in with us to enable us to care for our daughter and granddaughter. She deteriorated rapidly, and on the 2nd of June 2013, she passed away, leaving a heartbroken family. No parents, child, brother, and grandparents should have to go through this. As we've heard from many others this evening, early detection saved lives. Currently, 3 in 5 of people with pancreatic cancer are diagnosed with inoperable cancer. The vague symptoms mean it's difficult for GPs to identify those who need urgent referral for further investigation, and we need new tools to help GPs identify pancreatic cancer at an earlier stage, and technology that's been mentioned earlier, such as the breath test, being developed in tandem between Pancreatic Cancer UK and Imperial College London looks very promising, and these innovations will be essential in addressing the inequalities currently experienced in this cancer treatment. The new Scottish Diagnostic Pathway Improvement Project is an initiative set up to improve care and speed up diagnosis time for pancreatic and hepatocellular carcinoma. The pathway is demonstrating positive results, with the time it takes for scan results coming back to the referring clinician being reduced to just 2 days from an average of around 8 days. This allows treatment and support to start more quickly and support to be put in place to prevent people from deteriorating quickly. Due to the current late diagnosis of this, we need to do everything we can to improve survivability for those who develop pancreatic cancer. But beyond that, we need to ensure that for those whose cancer is not survivable, that they have all the support they require. The early experience of a constituent of mine that I shared shows that this is more than just a health issue. We need to ensure that where people have very little time left, they can get access to the support they need to make the most of the time they have left with their families, and that those families have the support they need after their loved one has passed away. Work to ensure that the public know the symptoms, that those who suspect they do have pancreatic cancer get easy and quick testing, and that those who are diagnosed get the quick treatment they need, needs to be prioritised to ensure that, as Willie Coffey said, we save time and save lives.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. I now call Marie McNair to be followed by Finlay Carson. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am grateful to my colleague Willie Coffey for securing this important debate on Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month. I know this is an issue close to his heart, having lost his own mother to this horrific disease. Since being elected in 2021, I have spoken in 2 previous debates on Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month, brought to the Chamber by my colleague Claire Addison, MSP. It is an issue that I will always feel is so incredibly important to speak on, and we as elected members are fortunate to have the platform we do, so we must use it to raise awareness and fight for better survival rates. This horrible disease has sadly taken too many of my constituents, and I'll pay tribute to them later in my speech. This Awareness Month is so important, and I take this opportunity to thank all the charities who do so much to raise awareness throughout the month, but all year round. Pancreatic cancer deserves much more attention than just for a month. And that's because it's one of the most deadliest of all common cancers, with a 5-year survival rate of 7.3%. There are over 900 new pancreatic cancer cases in Scotland and 10,500 in the UK each year. And unfortunately, only 10% of patients are diagnosed in time for life-saving surgery. And according to Pancreatic Cancer Action Scotland, patients will visit their GPs on average 4 times before being diagnosed. That is really worrying. We know that early detection saves lives, so GPs play such an important role in this. If not detected and left to spread, it can often be too late for any form of treatment. And that's why we need to do more, not just this month, but every month, to increase awareness of the symptoms amongst the public and GPs, and the signs and symptoms that may indicate pancreatic cancer, some of which have been mentioned already, are jaundice, upper abdominal pain or discomfort, mid-back pain, pale and foul-smelling stools, loss of appetite, indigestion, nausea and vomiting, new onset of diabetes, fatigue, changes in bowel habit and unexplained weight loss without trying. Improving awareness of the symptoms can and will save lives. And this issue is incredibly upsetting and can be very bleak when we look at the figures. But I do think it's also important to highlight what positive news there is. We have to have hope, don't we? It really is. I mean, if we don't have hope, what have we got? So it's really inspiring to hear that Pancreatic Cancer UK have this year funded a new clinical study to develop a breath test that could detect pancreatic cancer early enough to save thousands of lives per year. And the research conducted by the team at Imperial College London, led by Professor George Hanner, are studying to see if people can have early pancreatic cancer symptoms, which are often mistaken for other less serious health conditions, are instead rapidly referred for scans and life-saving treatment. And if successful, this could make the single biggest difference to pancreatic cancer survival rates in 50 years. And this would give GPs, those who are the first port of call for many health concerns, the tools to make such a difference. And this would be absolute heartbreaking and a breakthrough. And I really hope the team are really successful, and I wish them well. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to pay tribute to my constituents who have lost their lives because of pancreatic cancer. Helen, Donald, Billy and Christine will be forever missed, but never forgotten. And their memory lives on. Their family are resolute in their determination to find a cure for this disease. And I really will continue in their memory to do everything I can to raise awareness of this terrible disease and fight for more research to increase survival rates. We can and we must do more. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. And I now call Finlay Carson, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond. Mr Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And first, I can thank Willie Coffey for bringing this Members' Debate to the Chamber this evening. I'm not going to rehearse the stats we've already heard, but we know that early detection is crucial. And it's not acceptable that nearly half of all pancreatic cancer cases are only diagnosed in an emergency situation, where sadly it's often spread and too late for any curative treatment. So raising awareness is so important. Two of my friends died of cancer, this horrible cancer, Peter Murray Usher and Mark Cagle. Mark was told of his diagnosis in March 2020. And I sometimes look over the WhatsApp messages and photographs that we shared over that difficult time, and I haven't deleted them. Not that I need reminded of his mischievous banter, because his memory will always remain very clear in my mind. But his WhatsApp response to my initial reaction on him telling me about his diagnosis was to say, yep, and I quote, it's a bit of a bummer, but I've not given up yet. Dumfries Hospital just phoned me and told me there was nothing to be done. Shortly after, he made the decision to undergo treatment in Spain. Now, many of you will not remember the date as being significant, but on the 14th of March, Mark sat on an aircraft on the runway in Manchester for 3 hours before it turned round and returned back to the gate. COVID lockdown had struck. The country was in lockdown. Mark wasn't going anywhere. It was an awful situation for him, and his family's hopes were dashed. Mark died in August, 6 months after being diagnosed. He was the same age as me. And dozens of his friends and family lined the route from his home farm to his final resting place. COVID restrictions stopped us comforting him and his wife and his family. And he's missed dearly by his many friends every day. Now, I don't have all the facts surrounding Mark's experience, but I know it was far from ideal. But we do know that with an earlier diagnosis, pancreatic cancer can be survived. And we do know that pancreatic cancer comes with huge emotional cost for the patient and their family and friends. Now, Pancreatic Cancer UK has provided a very extensive briefing on the facts and figures relating to the disease, but being the last speaker tonight, I thought many of these stats would already have been raised. So I thought that raising awareness of some of the remarkable people who have taken on this terrible cancer head on. One case on the Pancreatic Cancer website involves a father of two, Stefan, who in 2021 at the age of 52 found out he had advanced pancreatic cancer that had spread to the liver and his lymph nodes. Stefan had undergone a CT scan after suffering abdominal pain, believing it to be an ulcer or a hernia. He was given the shock news by the on-duty oncology doctor that he had in fact stage 4 pancreatic cancer, which was inoperable, incurable, and he would be placed on palliative care. As he said, I had no idea what that was, so he asked. Then the reality dawned when he was told perhaps he had only 5 or 6 months to live. Telling his wife and children was incredibly difficult and emotional, and as Stefan said, something he hopes no one has to go through. He began chemotherapy in February 2022, But after 6 months, the chemo was making him more ill than the cancer was ever doing, and he suffered from severe fatigue, making it difficult to walk, and this prompted him to stop the chemotherapy. Anxiety was brought on by worrying over his finances and how his family would manage when he died, and Stefan suffered a mini breakdown. He didn't sleep, he came very inward, and would physically shake and flinch. Stefan's life had changed so much, and his words, "I think more so for my wife. Helen is always there, making sure I do what I'm supposed to, but she's always there for the children too. Her attitude and her conviction to all of us as a family is so important, inspiring and motivating, and it keeps me going." Bravely, he says that the family takes every day as a bonus and try to enjoy it the best they can. Remarkably, through all this, Stefan has started a fundraising campaign to help improve facilities at his local hospital. And 15 months on from his diagnosis, he's still here, but having to live each day as it comes. I think we'll all agree that he deserves enormous credit for sharing his brave fight against this cancer. His story and the many others who share their story on the Pancreatic Cancer UK site should be commended for their brave efforts to raise awareness. Pancreatic Cancer UK have recently launched Don't Write Me Off, a campaign calling for a faster, fairer funded pathway for people with pancreatic cancer through their diagnosis, treatment and care. Implementing an optimal care pathway could make a major difference to the lives of people affected by pancreatic cancer. It could in fact double treatment and survival rates and see around 400 more people with pancreatic cancer in Scotland living longer and better lives over the next 5 years if it was introduced today. Presiding Officer, Scotland is leading the way in pancreatic cancer innovation, with Pancreatic Cancer UK currently investing £520,000 in Scotland's cancer research. Mark didn't want written off. Stefan doesn't want written off, and we should make sure that the government doesn't write them off. More needs to be done, and done quickly, and we all need to play our part in making that happen.
Thank you, Mr Carson. And I now call Minister Jenny Minto to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to thank my colleague, Willie Coffey, for bringing this motion to the Chamber tonight and reminding us of the impact pancreatic cancer can potentially have on all of us. In addition, I'd like to thank and also welcome all the work that Pancreatic Cancer UK and Pancreatic Cancer and all the other charities supporting those with pancreatic cancer do, and also welcome them to the Parliament. I'd also very much like to thank all my colleagues for sharing such valuable contributions to the debate. I'm always very taken and moved by the experiences that we can share in this chamber, and I think Marie McNair is absolutely correct. We are in a fortunate position to have this platform, and I think the stories that Finlay Carson, Beatrice Wishart and Gillian Mackay have all shared, and others, are incredibly powerful and go a long way to raise the profile and the awareness of pancreatic cancer in Scotland and further afield. I'd also very much like to thank my colleague Claire Adamson, because it was through her that I learnt more about pancreatic cancer, and commend the work that she has done within this Parliament and really putting the person into the numbers. I think that's incredibly important. As I was preparing for this debate, I received an email from one of my constituents, similar to what Miles Briggs was talking about, and agree with him when he talks about the challenging picture. And if I can quote from that email, "It is a cruel, hard-hitting disease with devastating effects. I hope this debate will fuel the awareness that is so desperately needed for the world's toughest cancer. Earlier diagnosis is key for this disease, and I hope change is about to come to a cancer that has had no improvement in 50 years. And I think that highlights again what a number of contributions have said about the fact that families, people that have experienced pancreatic cancer, remain involved for that hope to make the change. We know the dreadful impact that a diagnosis of pancreatic cancer can bring to the person facing the disease and their family, as Finlay Carson has highlighted. The importance of person-centred care cannot be stressed highly enough to ensure that all patients get access to support throughout their cancer journey and that their voices and needs are heard. The Scottish Government continues to support the Single Point of Contact programme in 12 sites across Scotland. This programme sets out to make sure that all patients have a constant point of contact throughout their cancer pathway to continually refer back to, rather than needing to make new contacts as they go along their testing, treatment and post-treatment support. The single point of contact will ensure that patients are receiving timely and accurate advice on their appointments, tests and results. They will also offer the opportunity to discuss non-clinical support that is available, including linking them with other organisations who can provide the support that is needed. As we know, November is Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month. To recognise this, we will again light up St Andrew's House in Victoria Quay purple on World Pancreatic Cancer Day. Raising awareness of pancreatic cancer and its common symptoms is crucial in detecting this devastating cancer early, and I'd like to thank members for emphasising these symptoms. We know that the earlier cancer is detected, the easier it is to treat, which is why we continue to invest in our Detect Cancer Earlier programme. Taking a whole systems approach to early detection, it covers primary care, secondary care, public awareness, data and screening. I hope that most, if not all of you, have seen our awareness campaign Be the Early Bird this year. The campaign aims to reduce the fear of cancer and empower and encourage those with possible symptoms to act as early as possible. And by continuing to invest in cancer diagnostics and waiting times, we are striving to detect cancer earlier and faster. We are optimising diagnostic pathways and activating additional rapid care cancer diagnostic services. I would therefore encourage anyone with unusual or persistent symptoms to contact their GP as soon as possible. The Scottish Government published our ambitious new cancer strategy in June this year. Over the next 10 years, our strategic aim is to improve cancer survival and provide excellent, equitable, accessible care for all people facing cancer. The strategy takes a comprehensive approach to improving patient pathways in cancer, from prevention and diagnosis right through to treatment and post-treatment care. And we continue to have a focus on the less survivable cancers, including pancreatic cancer, and improving their outcomes. We've established the National Oncology Transformation Programme, review and optimise our service models to make this happen, including workforce and training requirements. Our workforce is central to delivering the outcomes of the strategy and plan. And as Willie Coffey said, we are determined to improve cancer survival rates and have provided over £650,000 to the Scottish HPV network to develop a pathway improvement project, pilot project for liver and pancreatic cancers, which is now live across all health boards. We look forward to the results of this pilot to improve patient experiences, and a full evaluation of the project's achievements against aims will be completed to inform decisions about future funding. Presiding Officer, in closing, I would like to make clear the Scottish Government's enduring commitment to improving pancreatic cancer awareness. In doing so, we can improve early diagnosis rates as well as improve patient experience and overall outcomes. And I spoke in this debate 2 years ago, and so I'll finish with the same words today as I did then. They are the simple and honest words from a family who lost a loved one to pancreatic cancer. They ring true for any illness, but even more for pancreatic cancer. Keep listening to your body. It is crucial that we continue to raise awareness of cancer symptoms, particularly among those less survivable cancers like pancreatic cancer. And I'd like to gratefully thank all of those who are helping to do so.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.